Well, I don't need water. Hello, brother. You ready? Uncle baby. Hi, everyone. How you doing? Can you hear me? Hi, everyone. All right, welcome to the Dale Experience. Hi, I like that. How you doing? I don't want to get the audio up a little bit. Wow. Bear with us. All right, guys, can you hear me? How you guys doing? Can you, more importantly, can you hear him? We need Randy up.
They can't hear me.
We need Randy.
Where's our audio guy?
We need Randy.
Where's audio?
Hey guys, we need Randy's audio up.
One, two, one, two.
All right,
two,
there it is.
Go.
All right, let's try this again. Welcome to the Dale Experience. All right, so we get to kick things off with Mr. Randy Jackson.
Yo, what?
About his career, of course, Dale Cinema, which makes it easier for us to have the best experience when we stream videos, listen to music. It's all about the great connectivity and the experience. And also, make sure that you put out on social media, I know you will, hashtag Dale Cinema.
Got us?
Got us?
Yo, I love that.
Hashtag, got us. She got us. Hashtag Dale XPS, because guess what? We're giving away, I call her Rosie, one of these. So we'll give that away later. All right, so Randy, you ready to get things started?
Let's go, let's roll, man.
All right, Randy, for Vintage Times, can we get a Yo Dog to start it off? We need something. Joking with you. All right, Randy, you work across all formats. When did you discover this love for music, for television? I mean, you've got it all.
I was a kid at 14 in Baton Rouge, Louisiana. My brother had a band in my mom's garage. They used to rehearse all the time, practice. So I kind of got the bug for music. There's when I first fell in love with the art form. And I was like, I would watch them rehearse. I was like, you know what? I really love this. I want to do this. I want to be a part of music somehow. I love that the emotional expression that you can make that was individualized, that became all just you, your own footprint. So I was hooked.
All right, we're hooked on you. You work on a lot of different projects. Which ones are you most excited to tell us about? Catch us up.
You know, listen, I think I'm really proud of a lot of work that I've done over the years. I'm so blessed and so fortunate. I mean, when I think about it, to work with the late, great Whitney, the late, great Aretha, the Elton Johns, the Billy Joels.
Alicia Keys, you were telling me?
Springsteens, the Alicia Keys, Journey, of course, Bon Jovi, I mean, Beyonce, Madonna. I mean, I feel so blessed in my career thus far.
Okay, so the bigger question is, who haven't you worked with, Randy? Is there anybody that you're saying, I need to work with them?
Yo, this is a true statement right here. Y'all ready for this?
Yeah. All right, exclusive.
I haven't worked with Dale, but I'm working with him.
Perfect.
It's all about that Dale experience, yo.
All right, perfect segue, because that leads me to, you are switching your entire studio from Apple to Dale. That's a big deal.
It's a big move.
Why did you decide to do that? And for you, what are the benefits?
The innovation, the quality, the speed. I'm telling you, a good friend of mine, a DJ that's performing here tonight, named DJ Sasan, said to me about a year ago, he says, hey man, I don't know, man, you better check out this Dell stuff. I think they're killing the game.
Yep.
I think they're ahead of everyone in the quality department, way over Apple. We've been using Apple forever. And listen, it's still great product, but I'm telling you, nothing does this. And I use the 2-in-1, the XPS 15. I can never go back. I have to have the touch screen. I have to have it.
Okay, question then. Besides the 2-in-1, the XPS 15, you know, I love my little baby girl, my 13.
Right.
What's another Dell product that you cannot live without? I love her because the battery life, it lasts all day.
Dell did a collab with Jack Joseph Poig, who's a great producer, engineer from Records Days in LA, and they made a 27-inch with these speakers on it that is crazy good. So those two products, in fact, the Glitch Mob was using a bunch of those last night.
We saw it last night.
At their show at Brooklyn Bowl.
It was really cool. I guess, can you expand a bit? You just told us that your friend who's a DJ said you gotta switch to Dale. You and I last night saw Switch Mob doing their thing. But Glitch Mob, for those who are producers here, who are in the music industry, who are thinking, all right, maybe I'm gonna switch to Dell. Why should they do it?
Here's what you don't know, what I didn't know, what I didn't realize. There's only one program that does not work on the PC Dell format. That would be a product that's owned by Apple and it's called Logic. Now, they've done a very good job. They've done a very good job of using it throughout the industry, and I was an avid Logic user. I was just at an Apogee event in LA where the creator of Logic was there, and I asked him the question. It was created first for the PC, but when Apple bought it, of course, it became proprietary. All the DAWs that you could love, that you want to love, Ableton Live, FL Studio, Pro Tools, everything you want to use is readily and easily available and was made first on a PC format.
Interesting.
All of the Akai, everything you think about in music was first developed on a PC format. So why wouldn't we be using PCs? I think the industry just doesn't know the power of Dell. But
this
they
gentleman's
will.
Having a reaction right there. What are you going through? All right. All right, you've worked with, as we said, the legends. Whitney Houston, Michael Jackson, Aretha Franklin, legends that aren't here anymore. So I guess for us, I'm interested to know, tell me a little tidbit about each of them that we might be shocked to know. Michael Jackson, let's start with Michael.
Well, one of the greatest talents I think ever to walk the planet. I mean, this guy lived and embodied the whole musical experience all on his own. Every video felt like a movie. I mean, this guy just, every song had an importance. It had importance of lyrics. When you think about lyrics today, and a lot of the trap and the hip hop stuff, I don't know what these lyrics are really about or what they're really saying. This guy was, I mean, he was dropping science on people's heads through his music and through his lyrics. Everybody wanted to follow him, be like him. He was like today's Elvis.
Okay, let's do. I had the pleasure of interviewing both Aretha and Whitney many times. For Whitney, what's something memorable that you shared or did with her?
Recorded with her the first time she came to San Francisco. I was working in the studio with a producer named Narda Michael Walden, and we produced the song. The first song we did was How Will I Know, which is one of Whitney's first big hits.
Wow.
She walked into the studio, she started singing, and we all had our mouths open because we've heard from Clive Davis how great she was, but we'd never worked with her. She started singing and she was unbelievable. And we stood there for about 5 minutes going like, have we just seen a ghost or what is this?
This young lady with that big voice.
That talent.
Let's talk about Aretha Franklin. I used to go to her birthday parties, which were the best things ever. Aretha was a trip, though. She basically did not fly. She was funny. She was fun. I have some good memories. Tell us some Aretha memories.
I remember being in Detroit many times. The first song that we recorded with Aretha was We're Going Riding on the Freeway. We were there for that, but my most memorable time with her was probably the George Michael duet, Knew You Were Waiting, because he was such a big fan of hers. And then I was there again with Whoopi Goldberg. We did the song Jumpin' Jack Flash with Keith Richards, Ronnie Wood, Steve Jordan, and myself for the movie. And everyone got there, and we were ready to record in the studio. And what people don't realize is Aretha was very old school. She was old school like Sammy Davis, Sinatra, Tony Bennett, these classics. These guys would come to the studio ready and prepared. They knew exactly what they were gonna do because that time in those days, you're recording with a live orchestra, you get a couple of takes. You better nail it and this is the album. Aretha had rehearsed it at home, learned it on the piano. She got to the studio and sang it once. So that vocal that you heard, and we were in the studio performing with her live, and we were like, she went in the studio and she said, you guys got everything you need? We're like, yeah. So who records something once? Today people are down to like 100,000 takes. You know, it's like crazy.
Oh my God.
But she comes in prepared. This is something the youth of today can really learn. Don't walk into the studio, even if it's in your Dell XPS 15 or 13 computer, be ready.
I love that. Excuse me. We all know who you are in the industry, we always have, but America really got to know you as a household name on a little show called American Idol. So,
yo, she's an Idol fan.
I am.
She was just FaceTiming Ruben Studdard with me.
She's one of my best friends, and I actually met Ruben when I first started my career covering Idol. So Randy and I have deep roots. You know, Randy, that show put so many people on the map, but also technology. That's back when we would run to phone, you know, like dial in. For you, have you seen the trends change with those shows, or have they? Do you feel like there's anything to improve upon?
I think Idol was a quintessential program, you know, and honestly, you'll hear everybody say everything, but the dog always keeps it real. None of us knew the show was going to be a success. We all thought maybe, possibly, but we were just through the moon that it was a success. It's one of those things in time that happens, you know, like someone used to say to me after everybody was leaving the show, Paula left, Simon left, somebody was saying to me, like, well, what do you think? I said, well, you know, it's kind of like, not that we're nearly as great as the Beatles, but if you have Paul, John, George all leave the Beatles, you're like, wait a minute, man. This is not even the Beatles anymore. What is going on here? So we were very lucky, very blessed, very fortunate to really come about at a time that we could really be honest. And let's also put this in perspective. Simon and I, yes, I was in Journey and had done a bunch of stuff, but Simon and I were not stars. Ryan Seacrest was not a star.
That's true.
Paul Abdul was the only star.
That's true.
So Simon and I were A&R guys. A&R at a record label means that you find, sign, and develop and nurture all the new talent, and you make every record that the label's going to put out. We did this for a living. Discover talent and find them. Someone would walk into the room, we'd see their face, a ticker tape would run down by their face with 40 boxes, we just check them off. Shy, bad posture, needs a haircut, needs new set of teeth, eyes too close together. I mean, we would run the gamut. Right. They would open their mouth to sing, and within like two or three bars, we'd go, right, great high register, bad low register, needs this kind of song. Sounds like would be a great song. So we really did this. We weren't stars on the show. So all the shows today are filled with stars.
Right.
So I don't know if any of the stars are looking for somebody to take them out the game. That's real talk. What stars on the show looking for the next replacement of them? None of them.
That's interesting. Flipping it on his head. Okay, I gotta ask you, we're gonna go off script a little bit. I was interviewing Jennifer Hudson recently, and she was talking about Simon gave her a
hard
time on that show.
She's honest, though, her and Kelly are honest because they came from Ireland. They came through the ranks.
But remember, we talked about this. Simon said, you're not gonna make it. He gave her a hard time on that show.
Yeah, but she was my wild card pick.
Okay.
I picked her as my wild card pick because I knew she had something. I mean, she was definitely that church girl, but she had a huge voice and huge potential. You just have to be able to see between it, you know what I mean?
Yes. Well, when you started on Idol, how did we consume our content? On television, right? So now it's all changed. We're streaming everything. That's how people do it. What are you forecasting going into this year about how we consume, what we do?
I think, listen, streaming is the way to go. It's like there's a big show in China. It's a hip-hop show. I think it's called Rap Superstar or something, whatever. I think the country banned hip-hop in China, but now the show is online. And it's five times bigger online than it's ever been on TV. So I think the power of what you're seeing, Jada Pinkett's got a show on Facebook. The show is going by leaps and bounds. Apple has their whole platform. You see Instagram TV. I think the streaming live of the shows is here to stay. I think you're gonna see this year become bigger than ever.
Technology impacted how you record, because, you know, people say now we don't ever go in the studio, we just email tracks now. It's just totally different.
Technology, that's what I love about Dell and the innovation. I was just marveling over the whole proximity sensor and just the intelligence of these computers. To me, today, the studio experience is so different. We could record right here with this crowd a song right now in your 30s.
Really?
Like, you don't need everything you needed before. So, I mean, it's a touch of ease. People can record on their phones.
What's the one piece of technology, just period, you cannot live without? Because, see, it's all about technology. Your daughter's here, she's filming you, everybody's involved.
I cannot live without my XPS 15 i9 32 gigabyte. Let me tell you something. This computer is bananas fast. It is crazy incredible, 2 terabytes. This computer, and also the best affordable price.
The price is good.
Whoa.
Price is right.
You're not breaking the bank trying to get a damn computer. What is going on? This is the future.
Did you name your XPS?
It can be there for everyone. Something for everyone.
I like that. Did you name yours? You know, I named mine Rosie.
I haven't named mine yet, but I'm coming up with some names.
Any good names,
I'm feeling
Dad?
Like maybe a name like Old Lord or something.
All right, so.
Or Count.
Count?
Yeah.
Any
I want to name it some British sort of, a Viscount, some British sort of thing. Right.
Let's get you a mic. Hold on one second. Wait. Renato, let's get you a mic.
I want to know from you. You are so important and you are so well known. Tell me what young people that can substitute you for the next 20 years. Tell me.
What they can do what?
What they can substitute you for the next 20 years as a musician, as an artist. I don't care about technology. I care about you.
We're not so we're at a technology convention, though.
What you can give you to the others, young people.
Listen, here's the thing. Two things will never be replaced in life.
I don't think so.
Two things will never be replaced in life. Talent and the great song. Great talent, great song. Anybody in music, film, TV, photography, video, coding, whatever, gaming, whatever, talent will never be replaced. Right.
Your talent, what you give your talent to me as a person.
You want me to give you my talent?
Yes.
Renato, one question a person. Okay, so we thank Renato for opening that up. Yes. We're going to open it up to everyone.
I'm going to will my talent on you right now.
We're gonna open
everything you can. Listen to people way smarter than you, and your mistakes, and the people that say no to you will help to define your character and where you go and how far you go.
I like that. Okay, so with that,
tell that to the 20-year-olds.
I'm sorry, I need to catch up. Good advice. I'm gonna open it up to everyone else for questions as well. So any questions for Randy?
Dell Experience. Dell Cinema.
I can't see you. All right, let's get you a mic. We're going to run you all mics.
I'll get to it in a second.
Out of every song you've ever recorded in your whole life, and I'm talking back to your Journey days, playing the bar gigs, bass, live or recording, what's your most memorable recording production moment of your whole life? Or the song, like name the song and the place. Where you were just slayed, dead, over, game over, bye-bye. What was it?
Man, that's really, really tough, man. You know, I recorded a lot of songs. I can't even remember them all, to be honest. I can't even remember all the songs. You know, listen, Blue Oyster Cult, NSYNC. I mean,
okay, your favorite moment with Justin Timberlake. That's
awesome. I mean, all the journeys. I mean, how can you? It's like saying, what's your favorite child? You can't do it, it's impossible. It's like saying if Michael Dell were here, what's your favorite product? He loves them all.
Right. Anyone else? Questions?
Oh, there's one over here. Running. Suzanne, what's your question?
Oh, well, after Suzanne, we'll get to you, Ronald, I promise. No, keep the mic.
I'm going to scooch in here. Hi, Randy. Thanks for coming out. I collect vinyl. I love vinyl. Now, you're working in a digital medium. So how do you talk to the people that are really old school and love the vinyl and the traditional tape? How do you talk to them about going into digital? What are your thoughts on that?
Well, listen, you can carry a hell of a lot more songs and albums on your phone and your computer. Nothing will ever replace vinyl. I mean, when you think about the inadequacies of that technology, but what it did to even, let's just talk about the low end, right? It wasn't as clear, because it was more like 8-bit or whatever, and it was on tape, and it had to be, but you could make it so hot. I mean, the record, the sound would just jump off of that acetate. Now, I think that what you're seeing, if we can get past If we can get the streaming guys, specifically iTunes and Spotify, to adopt a broader bandwidth, which they're starting to, that's what I will admit, the title sounds better than every other medium because the bandwidth they've allowed to expand.
So do you think the cinema sound?
We just have to get the guys onto that. Somebody has to make an industry standard and say, it needs to be this or bust.
Maybe it'll be you and Dill.
Yeah.
Yes.
So do you think cinema sound will help when people listen to them on their devices to be closer to that?
Yeah, because what you're doing, I mean, you know, listen, I worked at Sony for many years doing A&R, Columbia Records. Back in that day when I was working with Mariah and we spent a lot of time in Japan, at the time that the CD was like going through the roof, they came out with all different formats. You could have different sampling rates of whatever rate, 44, 46, 48, 52, whatever you wanted. But the idea was the consumer couldn't hear above that. So think about this. We've been relegated in streaming to iTunes in a format with the cheapest headphones that come with the iPhone that are equivalent of those things they hand out to you on an airplane that sound like dog ears. I mean, it's nothing but high end. There's no fidelity at all. This is not like Dell Cinema with its full range of like sitting in the movie theater. So that's the problem. So we got to make sure that there's a standard set and everybody has to adhere to it.
Thank you.
Ronald, okay, two more questions. I promise, Ronald.
Yes. If you only had three sentences of advice for all the aspiring young artists trying to break into the industry, what would you say? What would you say to them?
Three sentences. Learn everything you can. Always try and appear at the right place at the right time. Stay humble. And perseverance is the key. Never give up.
Those are good, yes. Final question. I don't know how you topped that, but who has our final question? Anyone? Okay. Oh, we've got one more.
Hi, how are you doing?
How are you?
So, my question is, what is your favorite genre of music?
My favorite what?
Genre.
Oh, dude, that's like the guy asking about your song. Like, I love everything. I love country. I love classical. I love hip-hop. I love trap. I love EDM. I mean, jazz, which I played forever, blues. This guy, Eric Gales, kills me every time. This guitar player dude from Memphis who now lives in Carolinas. Dude, like, I mean, there's some incredible talent.
Is there a genre you
blessed.
Can do without?
No, I mean, I love polka, I love bluegrass. I mean, I love talent. I love originality. I mean, you know, there's so many talented people on this planet. This is crazy. And I mean, you know, you can go on YouTube right now,
right,
and you can find some unbelievable talents at every age. I mean, you know, we're lucky and so fortunate to be in this world of such expansive talent.
And I have one more question. What do you think of the streaming apps and how they affected the music industry?
What, the what?
Streaming apps, for example, Tidal, Spotify, etc.
I think Spotify has now won the game from Apple. Because I think most record labels pay attention to it. I think YouTube's trying to do its thing, but Spotify pays the most per million views, a million streams. And I think they've really kind of cornered the market. Now, where that's going to go from here, I'm not really sure. There's talk that Weibo and Tencent out of China are coming into the States. Which are two amazingly giant platforms with billions of users, obviously, between China and India. I don't know what the future of it actually is, but I'm sure there's something new around the corner, but it's going to be around for the next foreseeable future.
Thank you so much.
All right, and with that, thank you all so much. I'm sorry. Thank you all. Thank Dale, and thank you, Randy.
Thank you so much, Alicia. Thank you, guys.
Enjoy CES, guys. All right.
What we're living in, let me tell you.